Welcome to Flourishment, the podcast on living life as you were meant to, so you can flourish. Welcome, everyone. I'm excited to have with me today Danny Ray, who has been performing his signature jaw-dropping illusions for nearly three decades. He's also a pastor with a master's degree from Fuller Theological Seminary. He and his wife, Kimberly, love to help couples develop stronger relationships. They've been married for 25 years and have fully navigated those ups and downs of marriage. Their story is compelling, and that is why Danny, with his magical way of presenting things, is here to talk to us today about creating a magical marriage. Welcome, Danny. I'm so glad you're on Flourishment today.
Hey, thank you for having me. Looking forward to it. And yeah, I appreciate you taking the time to make this happen.
So how does making a marriage better have to do with performing magic? How did you put those two together when you were thinking about this concept?
Yeah, so my wife and I, like you said, we just celebrated 25 years. And as part of that journey, we've had ups and downs along the way, but we've gone to marriage conferences, marriage seminars, read a lot of books. My wife's working on her counseling degree. We've both done a lot of counseling. And so a couple of years ago, we were like, what would it look like to take magic principles, you know, like misdirection or reading somebody's mind. So we teach you how to like read your spouse's mind, like take those principles and then look at biblical principles, biblical truths and see where the overlap is. So, you know, like there's a lot of biblical principles. There's a lot of magic principles. And so we found 18 of those that overlap. And so we took those principles and shared truth in each one through, you know, sleight of hand, as well as through God's word.
I love that. That is such a creative way to deliver a topic that most people are a little bit uncomfortable approaching. So thank you for doing that. That's really exciting.
Honored to do it.
Yeah. And I hope that among those principles, you talked about mind reading. You mentioned that as in terms of you can't really read one another's mind, because that used to drive me crazy when I was counseling couples. They always thought they knew what the other person was thinking. And strangely enough, the other person was always thinking something malicious in it, and it wasn't really true. So can you talk a little bit about the mind reading principle?
Yeah. So and we've heard that quite a bit in our counseling, like you can't read my mind, you know, like she wants me to read her mind or he wants me to read his mind. And so one of the things that as I do like a little bit of mind reading in my show, but I don't present it as mind reading. It's more like I make a prediction. Somebody says something and then I show the, you know, the prediction. But I've read quite a bit on mind reading over the years. But basically what a mind reader does is they use a small amount of information, and that information, they're able to gather a lot about that person. So for example, if I saw somebody who had yellow stains between their first two fingers, I could probably gather that person smokes. And so then if in the show I said, you know, I brought the person up and I said, hey, how are you today? And introduced myself. And then I said, do you ever have like a habit that you really want to stop and you've tried, but you just feel like you can't? Now it seems like it's really personal, but it's just using a small amount of information to gather things that are probably true about a lot of people that smoke, right? And so with our spouse, we get to gather a lot of information over time and not use that for entertainment purposes, but use that to comfort, to care for, to love that person. So one of the examples we give in the book is, let's say my wife says, you know, she on the way home from work says, I'm exhausted. Well, I know she loves Thai food. I know she loves a good bath. I know she loves a good book. So if I prepare those things for her and she comes home, it seems like I'm reading her mind, even though it's just using information about her to do to serve her the best I can.
I like that, because that's using clues to do something positive for the other person. That's an others-centered way of doing that. When I had people in my office, they were usually trying to do that for self-defense, and it doesn't work as well, and it becomes very divisive. They're looking for clues as to something bad the other person might be thinking, which they're usually not even really thinking.
Right. Yeah, a lot of things we stress over or think somebody else is thinking usually don't come to fruition.
Yes. So love-based thinking about the other person's perspective rather than fear-based and guardedness-based. So that's really good. What are some other tips that you would like to share from How to Create a Magical Marriage and the things that you do as a magical pastor?
So one of the principles we talk about is misdirection, right? Is magicians, they fake left, go right. And everybody thinks like, oh, if I could see the secret. Well, if you saw the secret, you would ruin the astonishment. And the astonishment in the show is what's real, right? Everybody knows they're going to a magic show that it's fake, that there's, you know, secrets involved. But when a magician's doing their job right, they get you to focus on that astonishment part and you experience wonder. And so it's not about focusing on the wrong things. It's about focusing on the right things. And the same is true in our marriages. When we focus on the things that God's designed for our marriage, one of those we just talked about is serving each other well, is learning to be selfless and not just looking after our own needs, but after the needs of the other, right? So that's one of the principles. We try to lay out the book in such a way from at the beginning of it, it's all about communication. And I know you would know this with counseling a lot of people, is everybody wants better communication. And so we laid out 6 principles, ending with creating bedroom magic, right? A lot of times we want to start with sex or intimacy in the bedroom, but it's been said before that intimacy starts in the kitchen. You know, it starts by serving and loving each other outside of just the bedroom and doing those things well. And then that leads to deeper intimacy in the bedroom. The second section we talk about is, you know, the secrets to overcoming. You know, anytime you've been married for any length of time, you're going to go through the loss of loved ones. We had a miscarriage at 4.5 months between child 2 and 3. It was devastating on our marriage. And so what do you do in those situations? And so by God's grace, we were able to get wise counsel and people to come alongside to grieve with us. People shared different verses to bring comfort during those seasons. And it's easy to get agitated with other person when you're grieving and not seeing it from their perspective and walking through those things together. And so we just talk about some of those principles. And that final part is on thriving, is we want to be a part of helping people create a thriving marriage. If you go to any, you know, magic show, concert, any like live performance, oftentimes there's a standing ovation or there's, you know, an encore. And if you think about that moment, you know, they had that planned, you know, like it's thought out ahead of time. And so in our marriages, do we think through like, how do we want, you know, not just like the end of our lives, but we could look all the way to the end and go like, how do we want to end up together? If we want to end in a way that we're giving a lot to other people, giving a lot to different organizations, if we want to love each other well, love our families well, like all those things, how do we get there? We had to start with the end in mind. And so we talk about how do you walk back to today and do those things. So for example, and we have a whole chapter on giving, but with giving, right? If you look at the end and you go, we want to be better givers, start now. So there's 4, 5, 6 missionaries that you go, wow, I wish we had more money to support them. Maybe you just go, you know what? We're going to give $5. We've got $30 a month that we could give to these people that we believe in. And maybe it just gives them a cup of coffee, but that cup of coffee might be exactly what they need at that moment, instead of waiting and going, well, we'll give when we have more money, instead of going like, let's start with a principle, like let's give well and start small and let that grow. So
I love that. That's every step leads you in a particular direction and you plan the steps to go where you want to end up. So that's a really great way of tying in magic to creating a magical marriage, because have you ever done a magic show that you didn't plan?
No.
No. I mean, how would that go?
Every once in a while, you know, people will ask like on the street or, you know, like somebody will ask to do something when I'm not, you know, like not necessarily prepared to do something. But most of the time we're, you know, hired in to go do an event.
But even with that, when you have practiced what you are doing and you're doing it well, when you're hit with something unexpected, you know how to respond. So that goes true in your marriage as well. When you're practicing the things that are other-centered, that are love-based instead of fear-based, that are selfless instead of self-centered, then when those unexpected things happen, you're able to respond to those well, right?
For sure. That's a great, yeah. And so even in those situations where somebody asks me, in a sense, I'm always prepared because it's my practice, what I've developed over years and years. And so I know in those situations, like, I'll be fine. In fact, I had one happen the other day, Tina, where I didn't do my research on one of the people that was interviewing me, and I banished 3 coins. And at the end of it, he said, well, where do the coins go? I said, check your wife's purse. He's all, I don't have a wife. But he was a pro and he recovered really well. He said, well, I'm just going to go down the street and check every woman's purse. And if they have 3 silver dollars, I'm going to marry that woman.
But that's really funny.
That's lesson one, and do your homework.
Yes. And that applies too to magical marriage, because you need to be paying attention. And that's part of doing your homework. If you're going to create an illusion that's marvelous, that astounds people, you've done your homework. You've done your practice ahead of time before that happens to some degree or another. And in your marriage, when you're paying attention to your spouse, that's you doing your homework, right?
Yeah, the paying attention is a crucial one. It makes the other one feel loved. We have a whole chapter that we deal with social media and things of that nature. And I know that's not where everybody is, but there's enough people in our culture that are extremely distracted by their phones, by TV, by their computers, by anything besides their spouse. And so we talk about that and the gift that is in giving your attention and really focusing on what your spouse is saying, instead of, you know, having half your attention there, half your attention on your phone, and really the other person feels less connected and less loved because you're trying to do 2 things at once. And so I would encourage anybody to really put their phones down, to have eyeball to eyeball conversation with their spouse. It goes a long way to show your love, and you're really able to pay attention to the details at that point.
And it's interesting that we use that phrasing, pay attention, because it is an expense. We only have so much attention to go around. So it's a sacrifice that we make to focus all of our attention on one person at a time, but it's an investment more than it is a payment, because it can pay you back.
That's definitely true. I love that.
So what are some other things that you want to make sure that people know about how to create a magical marriage?
You know, a lot of times people want to know, like, what's the key? What's the secret? And I feel like there's so many different secrets. I don't think there's any like one recipe that we could give to you. But one of the principles that my wife and I put into practice early on in our marriage that I think has transformed our marriage was not going to bed angry. You know, God says, don't let the sun set on your anger. And so we just put that into practice and went, what would it look like to never do that? And we've slipped up, and there's times where we're trying to, you know, work through things, but we can't. But here's the real secret for us with that, is it's been embarrassing and maybe humiliating at times to really put that into practice, because what we've done is like, okay, we can't figure out this argument. We're not going to get a solution by the end of the night. And so we'll call up a pastor, we'll call up a friend, we'll call up one of our counselors and go, hey, we need help and we need it now. If we don't want to admit like, oh, we've got problems, oh, we've got issues, we can't figure out this little argument, you know, whatever it is, but we'd rather be embarrassed and go to somebody and have them help than go to bed angry. And then that leads to bitterness. And I think a lot of marriages that we've counseled over the years, there's just this pattern of we just go to bed angry. And then the next day you wake up and those things grow, and that anger, that bitterness grows. And so my challenge would be, what would it look like to start fresh and to really go, okay, today we're going to work on this. It's not like you're going to, if you've had problems for years, you're going to solve those overnight, but it's the intention of saying, we're no longer going to consistently keep this pattern. We're going to work towards a new pattern of bringing hope and love and grace into the marriage. That's another one of the secrets that we just talked about is forgiveness and grace. Like we need so much forgiveness and grace in our relationship every day. I can't back out of my driveway without my wife going, hey, you're going to hit the fire hydrant, right? I'm like, I could get out of the driveway, right? But it's like, no, I need to show her grace and forgive her again and again with that. She doesn't do it necessarily intentionally, but it's one of those things where I'm like, it's not that big of a deal. And I don't need to get angry with her because it's the 100th time. I need to show forgiveness and grace because there's just as many of those that I do towards her that she could easily, you know, hold those against me. And we just don't want to do that with each other.
Really good. And scripture doesn't say you have to not go to bed until you've resolved every little tiny thing so that you all agree on everything. It says not to let yourself stay resentful when you go to bed at night so that it doesn't take a root of bitterness. So choosing to forgive is the first step, even if that step isn't fully completed and you haven't gone to the next step of reconciliation, you want to at least make that choice and ask God to help you forgive before you go to bed.
Yeah. And one of the things that we've noticed with both counseling others is just like any, like we look at forgiveness as a muscle. I'm glad you talked about forgiveness and reconciliation. Those are two different things. And sometimes we mix those together. And in Kimberly's corner, in every chapter of the book, she puts a little section on her perspective on that chapter. But with forgiveness and reconciliation, like with my biological father, he took off when I was about 4 years old, found out he was in prison when I was 18 years old for some pretty horrendous crimes. And the difference was I became a Christian at 17 years old. At 18, I wrote him a letter to let him know, like, I want to let you know Christ has forgiven me much, so I want to forgive you. And I think that pattern of starting that, it was a difficult process to go through. And I had to like wrestle through, and there was a lot of anger toward him that I had to work through. But that started that muscle for me of like, I want to be in the habit of forgiving people and not holding things against people. And that, you know, in our marriage, we started to work on that. It's in Ephesians 4:32, where it says that we are to forgive the way the Lord has forgiven us. And one of the things that I started to put into practice, believe me, I failed on this a lot, is I started to think, how does the Lord forgive us? He forgives us before we ever asked. While we are still sinners, Christ died for us. It's not, you know, when we ask that he goes, okay, now I'm going to forgive. Before we've ever asked, he's already forgiven. We get to choose to live into that or not. But I started to do this our first year of marriage, is if it was possible, I would forgive her before she ever asked. And it brought healing in the ability to reconcile much quicker. But you can't do that with everything. In Proverbs, it says, it's to your glory to overlook an offense. And so we've tried, it's from, we first read that in a book called Peacemaker by Ken Sandy. And it was the first time that we realized we don't have to hold these things against each other. If it's possible, just let it go. So like the driveway one, for me, this happens so many times. It's like, it's not that big of a deal. I'm just going to let it go. I don't need to get agitated with that or get angry or like, why do you always do this? Because another one is we try to never use always and never statements, because usually always and never statements are never true. Hey, there's a never statement. So, yeah.
That's true. And those hyperboles can get you in all kinds of trouble because that exaggeration, like in magic, is creating something that looks true. It's not really true. It's actually an illusion. It's a lie, in other words. So that's what a hyperbole is. It's an exaggeration that takes a partial truth and makes it into a lie.
And there's a lot of danger in that. So.
Yes, yes. We divide ourselves against one another and against God when we do those kinds of things where we're lying to ourselves in a way that's self-destructive. We think we're protecting ourselves at the same time, which is the odd thing about that.
Yeah, The principle for us that way is, and this is from a weekend to remember, a conference we went to when we were engaged, and then we did a couple of them while we were married. But they talked about this idea of fighting your battles back to back, is your spouse is not your enemy. And so it's just this beautiful picture of like, we've got a common problem, let's deal with it, but it's your spouse is not the problem. And when we really shift our thinking to go, like, we are on the same team, it's team us, and there's going to be things that we have disagreements on, and that's okay. But if we look at it as we're going to solve this together, not look at I'm going to win, you're going to lose, because that's a lose-lose situation in a marriage relationship.
Exactly. If one of you loses, you both lose. That's exactly how that turns out. That is so good. So let me take a second to do a quick commercial break. And if you happen to be stressed, whether it's because of things going on at home or at work or just in the world in general, I do have a course called Subdue Stress and Anxiety and a mini course for the holidays called Your Stressless and Joy-Blessed Holiday Season. If you are interested in either of those, I have special deals going on. There are many experts involved in these courses, and you can take them in 10 minutes or less a day. And that will make it so you're reducing your screen time, which is something that we just talked about in this episode, not staying on the screens all the time. So we will have those links in the show notes for you. And now let's get back to this discussion with Danny Ray about creating a magical marriage. I love that you are using these principles that are so compelling to frame what it takes to make your marriage more magical, more enjoyable, more of an experience that you want to live in forever, just like a wonderful show that you're enjoying, but you're participating in it. So talk to us about what your favorite principles are in the book that you and your wife have together and in the ministry that you and your wife have together.
Yeah, so one of the things that we talk about is, you know, you have lights, camera, action, right? For any show. And we talked about what does it look like when porn takes the center stage. Is pornography has become a part of our culture. And when that seeps into our marriage, that can have devastating impact on our marriage. And so when we're writing this, like, it's so tough to write about these things, not knowing exactly who's reading these. And I got involved in pornography. I don't want to go too much into like sexual abuse, but there's abuse that happened when I was a child, went on for a couple of years. And by 10 years old, I think I was looking at pornography. So it's definitely before puberty. And then, you know, you end up getting addicted to that, getting more of that. And then when I became a Christian, you know, at that time, it was, you know, a lot of magazines, ended up, you know, throwing all that away and thought, okay, that's the end of it. And then my wife and I, about 4 years later, we end up getting married. And during our first year of marriage, I ended up stopping him. It was a place I'd pass every day. There was this porn shop along the way to work. And on the way home one night, I'm like, well, no, nobody knows me. You know, like, I'm just going to go in there. And so I went in there. It was brief. There, you know, I felt ashamed. I walked out and then I was like, what am I doing? Like, this isn't who I am anymore. So we had a choice. And this is part of the principles of one of the things we talk about is like, magicians keep secrets, right? But they don't keep them from you. They keep them for you. So you could experience the wonder in our marriage. When you keep secrets, it creates division between the two of you, and it hinders both of you from becoming the person that God's designed you to be. And so I had to make a choice. Am I going to, you know, let this secret continue to grow? Or even though it had just happened, but I mean, it's in my head. I'm like, what do I do? And so I went home and talked to my wife, Kimberly, about it. And there's so many mixed emotions with that, because she felt like, oh, is it my body? Am I not beautiful? And so some real like self-image struggles that way. And, you know, what did I do? Like, is our sex life not good? All kinds of questions that she had. And at that time, I was 22 years old. I had a hard time answering those myself. But that was the first time we got in counseling. It was like, we don't want to continue down a path. I obviously hadn't dealt with it. You know, I thought just burying it was dealing with it. That's not. So we went to counseling, and in the counseling process, we started to see results and like, oh, there's hope and there's ways of breaking these cycles. And so it's like a weird thing at 22 that I made this decision that we were struggling a little bit that first year in our marriage. Then that happens. And then we come through, you know, maybe it was 6 or 8 weeks of counseling. I'm not sure exactly. But after that, we were dialed in and there was a deeper transparency and intimacy in our marriage. And not just like in the bedroom, just like in our conversations, we felt like we could be more authentic and real with each other and share deeper struggles and insecurities that we hadn't shared. And so it led to a better marriage. And I remember writing down in one of my journals, like, I will do whatever it takes to create a great marriage. And that choice has led us down a path that it doesn't matter what happens, we're going to create a great marriage. And so that's part of why we wrote this book, is we want to help other people, regardless whether you're starting out or you're in the middle of things, to continue to create a great marriage. Or if you're struggling, how do you get to a great marriage? Or if you're starting out, how do you build a great marriage?
That is so good. I love that advice, so that you don't allow that stronghold to get empowered and strengthened and fortified by the secret, because secrets are what makes strongholds stronger over you. So being authentic with the right people, whether it's your spouse, because your spouse is someone who's safe and you have a really good relationship with them, or your spouse and a counselor, because sometimes you need that objective person to be there for you so that you can make sure that there's not misunderstandings going on over that issue.
Right. We look at it as like tools in our toolbox, you know, is counselors one of those tools, you know, and sometimes we have the tools to deal with it. Other times we don't. And when we don't, we go, okay, let's figure out somebody, whether it's a friend, whether it's another leader, a pastor, or a professional counselor. And it part of that just depends on the severity of what you're dealing with at that time.
Exactly. And if there's a history of sexual abuse or something like that, you definitely want to look into potentially counseling, because they will know exactly what's going on with that and how to walk through that and get some healing from that. And for, you know, things that are not as much of a trauma or a crisis, you can probably work with a life coach or a mentor or a pastor on those kinds of issues. So that's really, really good advice. So how can people stay connected with you and find you and discover all of the wonderful places where they can see you performing and speaking, as well as get a copy of your wonderful magical marriage book?
So you could find me at DannyRayMagic.com and at Danny Ray Magic for all the social. We'll also be on Penn and Teller Fool Us on December 3rd. And if you're watching this after December 3rd, you could check it out on YouTube at Danny Ray Magic. I am really thankful to Tina for having me on, and I hope you enjoyed.
I hope that all of you thoroughly enjoyed this presentation by Danny Ray as much as I have, and that you will access his amazing book on how to have a magical marriage and check out that episode of Penn and Teller. That is so exciting. And of course, I also hope that you come back for the next episode of Flourishment. Flourishment is part of the Spark Media Network and can be found on the Edify app.